there are people, as I said, watching this session in the Zoom room here, as well as live on Facebook and YouTube. I welcome all of you to this pre-conference session. This international conference is intended to help the process of preparing a new plan to revive and modernize Kerala's agriculture and allied sectors. We hope to learn from other countries and states, from their successes, from what they have done right and well, and what we can adapt and adopt in our state. We look forward to your participation at the more detailed events on February 2nd, where we expect internationally renowned scholars to participate. Friends, we are nearly at the end of the 13th five-year plan for Kerala. In the 13th five-year plan, a major slogan put forward for animal husbandry by the Kerala State Planning Board and the Kerala government was to achieve self-sufficiency in milk production in the state. We could make excellent progress in this sphere. The total livestock population of Kerala, which fell between 2007 and 2012 by about 4 lakh animals, has risen by about close to 2 lakh animals between 2012 and 2019. This rise, though moderate, of the cattle population between 2012 and 19 is a sign of the success of the department's herd induction program. Between over the last 14 to 15 years, you will see that a total of more than 80,000 milch animals and about 18,000 heifers were distributed to the growers throughout the state. If we consider milk production in Kerala, there are conflicting conclusions we can draw from the data, and that's a problem. On the one hand, milk production in 2019-20 stood at about 25.4 lakh tons, which was only slightly higher than the figure for 2015-16, which was 25.2 lakh tons. Maybe if there were no floods in 2018 and 2019, there would have been a visible revival of milk production in the state. But this does not take away from the fact that the production figures do not show reason for too much of enthusiasm in the field of milk production. On the other hand, data with the dairy department will show you that Kerala's dependence on imported milk is declining. In 2016-17, about 9 lakh liters of milk were imported into the state on a daily basis. But by 2019-20, Kerala was able to reduce the dependence on milk imports to about 3.2 lakh liters per day. In 2015-16, Milma used to import at least 6 to 7 lakh liters of milk per day from outside Kerala. But in 2020, Milma was importing only about 88,000 liters of milk per day. Now, if you actually deduct what Milma exports to other states for conversion to milk powder, that is, Milma exports about 58,000 liters per day to powder factories outside the state. And if you deduct this, Milma's deficit actually declines to just 30,000 liters per day. So this fall in Milma's reliance on imported milk indicates a possible rise in domestic milk production, which is not adequately captured in official data on milk production. And this is something that we need more discussion on, including in this session and at the conference itself. It is from here that I come to the major topic of today, productivity and Kerala's achievement of self-sufficiency in milk production. Surely, the productivity of cattle in Kerala is higher than the national average. We can be quite proud of that. The average milk yield per animal in India for exotic crossbred animals is 7.9 kg only. But in Kerala, it is 10.2 kg per day. The productivity of 10.2 kg per day in Kerala for exotic crossbreds was the second highest among Indian states after Punjab, which has a productivity of 13.4 kilograms per day. This advantage for Kerala is largely because of the high percentage of exotic crossbred animals in the population. We have about 94% of our cattle which are exotic or crossbred, and only 6% as indigenous or nondescript animals. But in India, on the other hand, only 26% of the cattle are exotic or crossbred. And this is a major difference between India and Kerala. And this is one reason why Kerala's productivity is actually much higher than the national average. The question in Kerala today and for the next 5 years, 10 years, is how can we achieve self-sufficiency in milk production quite completely? And what do we do with that excess or surplus in milk production? We have to build for this purpose on the progress in artificial insemination and genetic improvement we have made over the years. And these gains have to be, or these progresses have to be converted into, translated into concrete gains in milk production. In our view, the high genetic quality of Kerala's cattle population is a most appropriate launch pad, a platform for a rapid rise of milk production in the recent future. At the same time, Kerala should also aim at improving the genetic basis of its livestock and raise productivity to the Punjab level at least. That is, can Kerala achieve productivity of milk like Punjab does? Can we achieve 14 kilograms per day of productivity from today's 10.2 kilograms per day? That is a question that we have to squarely face when we discuss the future of milk production in Kerala in the next 5 years or 10 years. And this is the topic of discussion today. There are two elements in which I would like to bring your focus on. One is achievement of self-sufficiency in milk production. And number two, how can the improvement in the genetic quality of Kerala's cattle population play a role in this process? So today's pre-conference session is more like a curtain raiser to the main sessions of the conference on the February 1st, 2nd and 3rd. We intend to put together the best of our minds in Kerala to lay out our challenges and chart out the broad paths to be followed in the future. We have a set of excellent speakers in today's session, Dr. M.R. Shashindranath, Dr. Jose James and Dr. Sudhir Babu. Dr. M.R. Shashindranath is the Vice Chancellor of Kerala Veterinary and Animal Sciences University. He specializes in the field of veterinary medicine, veterinary epidemiology, and preventive medicine. He has over 36 years of professional experience in this field, including more than 20 years of teaching. A fellow of the National Academy of Veterinary Science and the Indian Society of Veterinary Medicine, he is a recipient of the Bharat Ratna Dr. C. Subramaniam Award of the ICAR for the Outstanding Teacher Award in 2004-05. I welcome Dr. Shashindranath to this panel. Dr. Jose James has long years of experience in the Kerala Livestock Development Board. He has been with the board from, I think, 1988, and he brings in enormous amount of experience in managing the livestock sector of Kerala, and particularly the milk sector. And we hope to hear from him as well as to how we can improve our journey towards self-sufficiency of milk in the state. I welcome you, Dr. Jose James. Dr. Sudhir Babu, a distinguished teacher and researcher in the field of dairy sciences, is currently the registrar of the Kerala Veterinary and Animal Sciences University. He was formerly the professor and dean at the College of Dairy Sciences and Technology, one of the most respected scholars in the field. We look forward to hear from him as well on what we can do on towards the task of improving moving more rapidly towards achieving self-sufficiency of food production in the state. I welcome you also, Dr. Sudhir Babu. Now that I have welcomed everybody, I shall now pass on the baton to Dr. Shashindranath. Over to you. Kindly take over as the chair of the session.
Thank you, Professor Ramakumar. Good afternoon to everybody. Cattle in Kerala. See, if we think about our milk productivity in Kerala, if we go back a few decades back, you will see that each and every house has got a small cattle shed and two or three indigenous breeds of cattle of low productivity. Once we started our crossbreeding program in early 1960s, we found that the production is going up, as well as the indigenous population is coming down, and the disappearance of these cattle sheds from each house, and simultaneously, parallelly, mini and the medium sized dairy farms coming up. With the advent of crossbreeding using the exotic semen, the production has gone up, and we could see that the average national, the Kerala average production, as rightly mentioned by Professor Ramkumar, has reached 10.2 kg per day, comparing the national average, above the national average of 7.2 or so.
Dr. Shashindranath, there's a request from the organizers. Could you kindly come closer to the mic and speak? Because you're you're getting your voice a little bit vague here. So if you could, thank you.
Is it okay? Is it okay now?
Am I audible? It's much better now. Thank you.
Much better. Okay, okay. Right. So, at this moment, we are in a better position. Kerala is in a better position, having a national a productive average of 10.2 kg per animal, daily production. And what we are doing, though this production is high, we are not in a position to meet the demand and supply together. So we are forced to import milk from outside the state, from the Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. But this is also leading to reducing year by year. As mentioned by Professor Mohan Kumar, we have seen that the import also getting reduced. Again, that is a positive side, positive effect of our crossbreeding program or animal husbandry activities in Kerala. Then another major area, what we have done to solve this deficiency of milk is to bring in animals from outside. Due to the various activities or the various programs of governmental departments, or when a new entrepreneur comes into this dairy sector, we used to see that he is not getting high quality animals in Kerala. So again, he is supposed to go outside the Kerala for bringing animal to solve that problem, to meet that demand. So bringing milk from outside, bringing animals from outside, all this has got a negative impact on our economy. Secondly, bringing animals also lead to the bringing of so many disease conditions also to our population. Especially hemoproduction diseases is one of the important problem in cattle, dairy cattle in Kerala. Now, another problem what we used to face is the erratic production. See, during monsoon season, we get excess production and we are not in a position to utilize that milk properly. Then in lean season, summer months, we found that we are observing that we are not having sufficient milk to meet our demand. So again, we have to go for the bringing the milk powder from outside or milk from outside. Then recently, due to natural calamities like a flood in 2018 and 2019, our all animal husbandry activities have affected to a certain extent. And it has been observed that there is a decrease in the production rate, minus 1.1% of milk production has been recorded against the 6.5% of a national average. So all these points together led to think about how we can solve this. Our demand is great and our supply is less, and we have got sort of a lot of challenges. So what are the challenges? How we can solve this challenge? One of the most important thing what Professor Mohan Ramkumar has mentioned is the genetic improvement, availability of a large number of cattle with high genetic potential. See, we have different types of genetic potential, and in detail, Dr. Joseph James will be speaking. And we tried, we are trying our animal husbandry department, our dairy development department, our milk cooperative society, all are having very good infrastructure for providing support to the farmer. And provided this animal having high genetic potential, it is not only sufficient to have animals of high genetic potential. If you go village area and you will see that the animals are of good quality, but they're not getting suitable environment for expression of those high genetic potential. That is the most important thing what is existing in the field now at this moment. So for that, we have to go for the managemental side, feeding, housing. Especially now, the climate change effect is also there. Increase the heat stress. How to manage? So here also, our departmental organizations like universities or other research stations, they are doing work and they are getting a lot of information. The adoption index of these innovations to the field level is not to that expected level. Even yesterday, when I attended the agriculture session, I found that even in agriculture session, the innovations, the adoption of the finding into the field level is very, very poor in certain area. Even in the example, there's like a lime application, farmers are not at all willing. So our extension, what we have to, whatever we are finding in the laboratory has to go to the farmer ultimately. So that part we have to concentrate. There are a lot of genetic tools improving the genetic constitution, then even genome study, then feeding. This is another important area where we have to concentrate. Feeding the animal having good potential, genetic potential, but if it is not getting proper nutrition, then again the problem comes. The animal will not be able to express and produce the milk. So that area we have to concentrate. Then all other management aspects we have to see. Then another area is fodder. See, in Kerala, what is happening is the fodder development and the dry matter availability for the cattle of the farmers is lacking. So for that, there must be sufficient fodder, green grass available. So that part is also we have to think about. Again, all Kerala level, we have done mineral mapping. Even the infertility problem is one of the important things in crossbred animal. So the mapping, mineral mapping has to be done of the fodder, of the soil, and of the animal. Blood, we have to see that. And in so many studies, we found that these are correlating. So that part has to be taken care of. Then, see, now, even during the last flood season, we found that the fodder, again, fodder availability and the mineral mixture availability and the feed availability. So a lot of things have come in the laboratories. The EMR blocks are available. So such thing has not penetrated into the farmers level. So that part also has to be taken care of. Then ultimately mechanization. Mechanization is the one important area where we have to concentrate and reduce the labor cost. So newer and newer entrepreneurs are coming into this field, and whenever they come, the government as well as the various organizations, they must encourage them and they must give proper training, even the financial support. That is one important thing we have to think about. As far as infrastructure is concerned, in animal husbandry activities, our animal husbandry departments, they are well established. Then dairy development department in all districts, they are doing wonderful work. Then milk cooperative societies are working in the village level in a very nice manner. So that part, we are in a better position. And if you take the Kerala as such, we will see that we have sufficient good water is available, good soil, fertile soil is available. Then climate is also comparatively better comparing so many other states of India in this broad sort country. So our main concern should be how to increase the number of, already the 2012 and 2019 census shows that there is around 18% increase in the crossbred animal in Kerala. So it is in the positive side. So we have to think how we improve the genetic constitution and how to provide sufficient and suitable environmental situation for expression of that genetic potential. Then other few other skill supports from the government, attracting unemployed youths, especially those who are coming from abroad. We will have to give positive support from our government. We have to give training. And even another area where our farmers to increase their income by value training and value added products, that Dr. Subir Babu and Dr. Joseph James will be dealing. Then another area where we have to think about is the heifer nursery. Heifer nursery. We have seen nowadays the buffalo calves are coming in plenty, and they are growing and they are selling for meat purpose. But here we are not concentrated so far much among the public regarding the heifer nursery of supply for the supply of dairy cows in future. Then another important area where we have to discuss is fodder cultivation. Fodder cultivation can solve the problem of the deficiency of the dry matter. Here the main problem with regard to farmers are they are not in a position to sell this fodder. So that part also has to be solved through the cooperative societies. Then long-standing demand from the dairy farmers is another, to include them also, consider them also as a Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Guarantee, Employment Guarantee Act. So that part also to be, because this is a 24-hour job, and they have to be considered at par with the agriculture leverage. So I'm not taking much time, and here to discuss the different points, we have two eminent speakers here, Dr. Josh James, Managing Director of Kerala Livestock Development Board, and Dr. Sudhir Babu, Registrar, Kerala Veterinary and Animal Sciences University, and former Faculty Dean of Dairy Science and Technology, KVISU. And now I invite Dr. Josh James for presenting his talk. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, you are, Dr. James. Can you please be a little louder and maybe closer to the mic, please?
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
The slides are coming. So, good afternoon once again, and thank you, Professor Ram Kumar and other officials of the Planning Board, for giving me an opportunity to share with you some views which the animal breeding and the animal livestock development sector is doing for the last few years, and what we achieved and what we should do further. So I think I will just can share the screen also. Okay. So I'll just request the Nagesh sir to kindly instruct your people to share the screen also, because I have few slides also. I've already
you can share the screen from your side.
So they are disabled, sir.
Disabled.
Yeah. So I already told the Sangeeta.
Dhanya, onnu nokku adu. Enable cheyidittille.
Yes, now it has come, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
So I know the time constraints. So I have actually about 30 slides, and I will be just running through the slides, because our Professor Ram Kumar and our Honorable Vice Chancellor has already given some inputs which has come into my presentation also. So see, here actually what I am trying to do is, there will be five areas where I will be touching. What we have been doing, what we did in the early what we are doing now, and what is the impact of this, what are the related issues, and how to go about to achieve a reasonable productivity level for the animals in the state. So we know we started with a very humble beginning in the 60s with a very nondescript animal, which was hardy and it was very well adapted to the tropical situations in the, which existed at that time in the state. But, you know, as a part of the national strategy for augmenting milk production, crossbreeding was adopted all throughout the country. In Kerala, the pace was slow in the early 60s and 70s, but after 70s, considerable effort has gone into in upgrading the genetic structure of the animals and also the improving the sector. A lot of early breeding experiments were carried out by the Dairy Development Department, key village schemes, crossbreeding experiments using Jersey bulls, and then came the Indosis project in 1963. It was a bilateral project which started off in Matupatti and Pyramid in the high ranges. So it was Indosis project which actually led the state into the right track for crossbreeding. So they adopted a first their own breeding program. They purchased a nondescript animals in the 63-64 period. They imported brown Swiss brown bull semen, and also imported Swiss brown bulls. Crossbreeding was started. They produced different combinations of crossbreeds. They studied and they compared the performance, both production as well as the adaptability of the different crosses. And then they, hypothetically, they arrived at their own breeding policy, which they were using in the breeding farms as well as in the circuit A areas in Pyramid. And that was the saw the launching of the frozen semen technology also in the field, first time in the country in Matupatti. And the circuit A was expanded to Pyramid area in Idukki district alone. Gradually, through the intensive cattle development programs, it was brought down into the lowlands, especially Bavelgira during the 1970s. Then the special employment program launched by the Dairy Development Department, a lot of cattle improvement assistants were employed. Then in 1977, the progeny testing program was launched by the state for the first time in the country, and it is being continued till date. And then the crossbreeds which were evolved during this process was given a name. But still there was some breed barriers existing, you know, in the northern part of Kerala you use Jersey, and in the southern part you use brown Swiss, like that. All things were hypothetical based on some experiences, but not with that much data better. Then the state started thinking of a breeding policy, cattle breeding policy. So we can be proud that Kerala was the first state to at least come forward with that thinking to start a breeding policy. It was initiated in 1979 with some thoughts of limiting the exotic inheritance and how to lift the breed barrier to bring in uniformity in supply of germplasm around the state, and also to bring in more bulls through progeny testing. It took about 12-13 years for the state government to get that document accepted as the first breeding policy in 1992. Thereafter, it went off, you know, there was a series of transformations which took place in the breeding policy according to the changes that happened in the state on the social part and the economic part and on the farmers' demand side. 92, it came, 98, there was a review, 2008, there was another review. Some small modifications have been suggested in that. And all these policies came as government orders, and all the stakeholders in the sector has the document with them. In 2018, there was a very detailed review on the breeding programs, policies, and how to improve the genetic structure of the animals, the productivity, the management situation also. Because breeding policy, the thought was, as our Honorable Vice Chancellor has rightly put in, is not the genetics alone which is playing in the realized productivity of the animals. We know the situation in Kerala. I will come to that later. So there were some fine tunings were made in the breeding policy in 2018, because there was a shift in the dairying pattern in the state from smallholders to commercial or semi-commercial dairy holders. So farmers who are on the commercial front, they were able to supply good resources. They were progressive farmers, and so a little bit more of exotic level in the germplasm, such pools could be used for them. That was one major change which was suggested in 2018. Along with that, the climate change issues were also discussed. So we have to give thrust for the indigenous animals, which are more hardy and adapted to our conditions. And of course, as our Vice Chancellor rightly put in, a feed and fodder policy, because without that, there is no meaning in improving the genetic structure. The animal, to express its potential, we are bound to give a congenial environment, at least an optimum environment for that. So some suggestions came up there also. Then very important aspect of supporting the cause, which will come later. So then, of course, utilizing the genomic technologies, molecular biotechnology and all. So this is the current breeding policy, which is the policy of the state and not to any individual organization. Each and every stakeholder in the animal husbandry or livestock sector of the state has their own defined roles in the breeding policy. It is not alone the supply of semen, but there are a lot of things which we have to do after this semen is coming to the AI center. So we are now following an interstate mating with the intensive selection, because we have about 94% crossbreds which are having different combinations. You can say there are two lines of crossbred Jersey and crossbred HF, but they have indigenous blood in them, exotic blood in them, with the wide ranges. And if I just glance through the programs which we are doing now, the breeding program, we have a three-tier organization in the state. We have three bull stations. The bull stations produce the frozen semen as per the mandate of the state, as per the breeding policy of the state, in line with the minimum standard protocols which have been formulated by the Ministry of Agriculture, Government of India, and we are bound to follow it. So the MSP is the Bible for the frozen semen production stations. So according to that, we are maintaining the bulls, producing the bulls and supplying the semen through the regional semen banks. We know we have 14 districts, one regional semen bank for two districts. And they will procure the required semen doses and supply to the 2,976 AI centers now functioning in the state under different agencies. And of course, in the breeding part, in order to ward off undesirable characters, to minimize inbreeding, we follow a bull rotation program and we limit the production per bull to 1 lakh. As per the minimum standards protocol of the Government of India, we can go up to 3 lakh doses per bull in the productive life or 10 years, whichever is earlier. But since Kerala has a very small breedable population of about hardly 7 lakhs animals, we cannot simply go in for producing more bull semen from a particular bull. So we limit the production per bull. Then we select only maximum 4 male calves from a good bull mother. Then F1 bulls are continuously being pumped into the germ pool of the state from other sources. And of course, we are importing bulls from other states and also semen and bulls from outside the country. And also embryos are imported for producing bulls for the breeding program. And I told you about the bull rotation program. All the bulls are grouped into three families, and these three families will go according to the breeding zones. The 14 districts in the state are divided into three breeding zones. One particular group of bull semen will go to one zone for a period of 3 years. After 3 years, what happens? The breeding zones remain the same. The bull group will be rotated. And when new bulls come into the program, they will be inducted into the concerned bull groups. And we provide the entire details of the bulls are printed and given to all the AI centers in the state, indicating the INAF code itself. I'll tell you about the INAF also. All details, the pedigree of all the bulls which are being used. And you can see the group one, group two like that, which district it is supposed to go. And the bulls which we are using normally are crossbred Jersey and crossbred HF land from Sujandinis. F1 bulls, Kerala produced some F1 bulls, and also we are getting bulls from the Bull Distribution Committee of the Government of India, from Andhra Pradesh, NDDB stations, from Tamil Nadu Livestock Development Agency, from Rajasthan, and from UP. And also we will be using imported semen, imported bulls, sex semen. And these are the normal bulls which we are now using for the breeding program, crossbred Jerseys, HF, pure Jersey, pure HF, and Buffalo is this Mora. And of late, we have started supplying semen from the indigenous animals also, because now the national policy has changed. They are limiting the crossbreeding with exotic breeds, and more thrust is being given to upgrade the best indigenous animals. So Kerala is also moving in that direction, and government is also insisting, especially in the breeding policy, it has been mentioned, farmers are also free to maintain indigenous animals. And we are also selecting animals from farmers and in our PT program and using them for the breeding program. And coming to the semen production management, as already told, there are three semen stations following the MSP, and 2,976 AI centers are there as on date. About 83% of the AI centers are manned by the Animal Husbandry Department. And they are responsible for the artificial insemination, pregnancy diagnosis, follow maintenance of related records, and the KLDB is doing the supply of inputs, semen, etc. And recently in the breeding program, we are using more of bulls born of ET and IVF, and sex sorted semen we have started using since last 3-4 years. But unfortunately, the demand from the AI centers for sex sorted semen is not that encouraging. And genomic selection also, we have started about 3 years back, and the state has an MOU with the University of Adelaide, Australia. And the results which we are, the data what we are producing here is given to them, and they are scientifically evaluating and providing the data for the results for us. And also we are introducing superior germplasm from outside stores, state sources. We are a part of the bull distribution committee based on the breeding value. And from abroad also, we are importing superior germplasm in the form of semen, bulls, and embryo. And all these animals are being pushed into the genetic pool of the state. So as Ramkumar sir earlier told, we had a structured and scientific breeding program over 4-5 decades, a very good implementable breeding policy when compared to other states. We could convert more of our, most of
Dr.
our...
Dr. Jose, there is a time constraint, so can we conclude in the next 2 minutes or so?
Yeah, 2 or 3 minutes. Okay. So the population, already Dr. Ramkumar has told, milk production also we know. The productivity you can see since last 3-4 years, it's ranging between 10.17 to 10.25. And in progeny testing areas of KLDB also, we get the daughter's yield of the test bulls. It's ranging between 11.17 and 11.56. And milk per lactation is also around 3,500 kg. And when we compare with the other 15 major milk producing states in 1890, as Dr. Ramkumar told, it is Kerala is in the second position. And we should think of other than genetics also, we have to think of the extrinsic factors which exist in the state. As our Honorable Vice Chancellor earlier told, even though the animals are having the genetic potential, especially in the rural areas, if you go, the farmers are not able to feed their animals properly because of various reasons. So there are two issues which we have to address. Of course, we have to spruce up the scientific breeding, significantly better breeding program if required. There should be efficient feed management interventions. And we know now these crossbreeds are almost reaching a production plateau if you see the data. So how well we can penetrate this and come up should be the thought of for the future. And feed problems, there are a lot of issues, high cost, availability problem is there. Government is doing a lot of effort in improving fodder and feed production, but still situation is poor. The data published by NDDB in 2016 shows only 26% of the requirement is met in the state. And in the Planning Board Report Economic Review 2019-20, we can see the area under fodder cultivation is coming down. It has come down to around 2,500 or so acres. So this area has to be given more thrust. We have to have a feed and fodder policy also, which should go in concurrence with the breeding policy. Then, of course, the genetics part, we have the flowchart, how we are organizing the program, how the bulls are being produced, what are the bull mothers farms doing. There are two progeny testing projects. So this is very important area where we have to trust because the sustenance of the BT project is also very important for further development. Another major two areas which we have to consider is the delivery part of the.
Hey, Dr. Jose, I think we will discuss this if any questions comes on this.
Okay,
time so, please.
Two more issues only. One is regarding the AI delivery and what we are doing with the best cars which we are producing in the state is a very important thing. We are going and purchasing unselected animals from outside state, whereas we are just neglecting the cars which are being born in our state. And the support which the farmer requests to maintain these cars is a very, very major area of concern which we have to think of. Climate change issues we have to think. So to conclude, these are the points which I thought I just pushed into the minds of the people. We have to avoid further decline in the number of cows, but there should be a minimum number of animals. Without that, we will not be able to achieve any self-sufficiency. And as people talk, with our experience, we cannot jump from 10 liters to 40 or 50 liters as is being done in the developed countries. But a reasonable level of 13.5 to 14 liters we could achieve, provided we support some of the extrinsic factors also. And also we have to assure up the genetic improvement activities, which we should, the state should own it, because genetic improvementing is a social, should have a social objective. And it should not be thought on commercial lines. That if you see the literature of many of the countries, that is the objective, that was the subject for concern of many of the developed countries. Progeny testing program, we have to continue. Government of India is now confining this to bull production only, but the states should have their own progeny testing program, because we need animals which have been proven for our situations, not in Gujarat or not in Andhra. That is our concern. Then we have to improve the genetic structure, and there should be a situation analysis, because many people, as our member of planning board has told, inconclusive data should not be there. There should be a situation analysis. And because our socio-economic scenario is changing very fast, and are we in pace with that change on the genetic side, on the management side? So these things we have to discuss further. And I am concluding here with this presentation. Thank you very much for a patient hearing.
Okay, thank you, Joseph. Now I invite Dr. Sudhir Babu for the next presentation. Please.
Dr. George James, at the end of his presentation, was mentioning about the situation analysis. From there itself, I can start, I think. See, at the time when we are analyzing the strategy to be followed for attaining self-sufficiency, we have to analyze the situation, where in which, to what extent we are deficient, and for how long it can go ahead like this. If you are just looking back in the sense from the post-independence period, if you are considering up to 1992 period, we were self-sufficient in milk production in Kerala. As we all know, during that period, the de-licensing of dairy industry, the milk and milk products order 1992, together had made a sea change here in this sector. At that time, I was working with a dairy machinery manufacturer there in Pune, and there was inquiry from all states here in India to go for new installations for dairy processing as well as milk chilling plants. As you all may aware, this was a protected licensed area prior to 1990 period. After that, de-licensing came. Any entrepreneur, any farmer group, cooperative society, based on any that can enter into the field, either for collection or for processing. At that time, till that time, Kerala was self-sufficient in the sense that for the inflow of milk into any market, any state, it is, unlike other agricultural commodities, you need basic infrastructure, primarily for the semi-processing, I can say the facilities for refrigeration, either a bulk milk cooler or an IMCU, with the help of which you can get it chilled, and huge quantity of milk, maybe 10,000 liters together, can be transported from one place to another. That type of facilities, not common in the sense they're in the private sector prior to the de-licensing. Once it came in, what happened if we are making a survey of the dairy processing facilities here in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, for example, we will come to know about it. Large number of private entrepreneurs are here in Kerala, but they have the facility for pasteurization and packing. And the chilling plants for collecting milk locally by a private entrepreneur can never see here in Kerala. But in Tamil Nadu, large number of plants are there, maybe BMC or IMCU, collecting huge quantities together. That means even though the dairy enterprises came here in Kerala, they were sourcing milk from the neighboring states. There was the competition between the local cooperative, those who are collecting milk and selling here, with the private entrepreneurs. But the major difficulty that we have faced, unlike other states, was that sourcing was from outside only, from other states only. And gradually the market share of the private entrepreneurs came up to 10 lakh liters. Sometimes it may go down to 7 to 10, it will vary. That is the way in which it is existing at present. And if you are just looking at the figures, for example, the total milk production in Kerala, it may come near about 72, 73 lakh liters per day, out of which Milma is collecting 18.6 lakh liters as per the recent figures, out of which near about 13 to 14 lakh liters they are processing and packing in the form of pasteurized milk in pouches and selling it here. Near about 9 lakh liters of milk in pouch form is being marketed here in Kerala by private entrepreneurs. And if you are planning to go for sufficiency, what is the gap? The gap is nothing else. This 9 lakh liters of milk, which is sold here in Kerala, which is sourced from outside. And at the time we are addressing, we are trying, making an attempt to capture this market. The question is it viable? Is it possible? See, Kerala is a deficient state, no doubt. But the farmer of Kerala is getting the highest price for milk than any other state in India. If you are considering the milk price for a farmer here in Kerala with 8.4 or 8.5 SNF with 4.2 fat and all. The price, if you are comparing with a farmer there in Tamil Nadu, he is getting near about 7.52 rupees in excess. A deficient state dairy farmer is getting a near about 7.52 rupees higher than that there in a milk surplus state of Tamil Nadu. The price difference between Avin and Milma in that sense. It's very simple. If the demand is higher than supply, you will fetch a better price. And the farmers are getting the advantage for that. Of course, if you are trying for increasing the production so that these 9 lakh liters can be produced additionally, there's nothing wrong in it. But the only issue is that you can't control, you can't ban the entry of milk from the neighboring states. No policy can be taken like that. You have to control only milk. You are depending the same states for all other commodities. Milk alone cannot be banned. If I am saying 7.50 rupees is paise less there in the Avin milk price, Avin is not collecting the entire quantity of milk there in Tamil Nadu. If you are comparing with Milma, their collection is much lower than the total production percentage here in Kerala. That means if Milma is collecting near about 80% of the surplus available, not the entire quantity, surplus milk available, there it can be 20 or 30%. The rest is being collected by private entrepreneurs. That means the price will be again less. Near about 10 to 12 rupees difference will be there, always there in the price. And the entrepreneurs, those who are selling here in Kerala, they are able to capture the mark in the differential market. For example, for household market, generally Milma will be having the brand loyalty and it will be possible for them to capture the market. But for hotelers, or catering agencies or large scale buyers, they will always go for cheaper milk. Earlier, always there in the advertisements or in the propaganda, we used to say that the quality of the incoming milk from the neighboring states is poor. There is pesticide, there is antibiotic residue, there is preservative. But nowadays, that type, the number of cases generally is less. In the sense, very good vigil we are keeping with the help of Food Safety Department and Dairy Development Department. And this particular segment of 9 lakh liters, which is being fed by the low-priced milk from neighboring states, can never be attained by the local production because our production cost is high. We are getting a higher price for the farmer. And if you are trying to aim at that, it will end up in surplus. It will end up in surplus because of some other reason also, because we know it very well, there will be 20% of fluctuation, lean flush difference would be there for milk. During a rainy season, again, it will be higher. Then the local cooperatives will be finding it difficult if the production is shooting up to collect this quantity. Then what will happen? That much of milk surplus during that period will be a burden for the cooperative societies. Even during this COVID period, Malabar Regional Cooperative Milk Producers Union, they were finding it extremely difficult. Near about 1.4 lakh liters of milk per day was the surplus. More than 1 crore liters of milk they have converted into powder. Naturally, there can be a question, why can't you think about converting these huge quantities into products and powder? Again, the issue is that, for example, the easiest method is to go for spray drying. Of course, we don't have a spray drying facility at present here in Kerala. You are getting it done by sending it out. There is a proposal to go for one by the government. But the issue is that the TS rate at which we are purchasing milk here in Kerala and getting it converted, then conversion cost together, generally it may come near about 350, 360 rupees per kg for 1 kilogram skim milk powder. But the market rate at present available will be 230 or 240. That means conversion also is not the answer for it. Of course, conversion can be considered as a measure to store the surplus, which can be used for the RC purpose, reconstitution purpose during the other season, during the lean season. Otherwise, if you are planning to market it as dairy whitener, you can't compete with the milk powder available or milk powder imported from the other states. That means that option also is not that bright. That this is not a what I can say new phenomena. Most of the developed countries dairy where the dairy sector is very what I can say developed, like New Zealand or Australia. Whenever they are throughout last what I can say decade, they are facing the problem of excess production, how it can be dumped into the other countries. Even the RCEP agreement itself, during that discussion, it came up many a times, because too much of production for a perishable commodity like milk will create that type of issues. Otherwise, we should have a very specific plan. For example, if you can think about a new product development, unique product development based on milk, maybe an Ayurvedic product, a nutraceutical product, which can be in the form of a spread dried powder, and which can be encapsulated. That type of product manufacturing, and for that purpose, for high value added products, if we can make out of it, of course, that will be a separate market. But if you're considering the float milk as such, capturing or aiming at the same market will be too difficult for us. And we are facing other type of problems also. For example, Amul. I told you Milma is getting brand royalty here in Kerala primarily because it is a cooperative. And for a long time, that brand is known to us. Amul also is similar. Now, Amul is putting up processing facilities, or they are leasing out or franchising other third-party operators for processing and packing milk. See, in many other states, they already had started. They are sourcing milk And now their plan, to the best of my knowledge, is to put up a plant there in Tamil Nadu, collect milk locally from there, process and pack and sell it over here in Kerala. Just see, then the competition will be too high, because a cooperative giant like Milma is, Amul is competing with Milma. That type of situation also we are facing. And for example, if RCEP agreement of or something of that sort is coming into force again, that means import of milk powder at a cheaper rate also may happen. From my side, I would like to look it back from market to production. No doubt productivity has to be increased. It doesn't mean that huge quantity production has to be promoted. Because at present, if you are considering 70 or 75 lakh liters milk production in a state and importing a quantity near about 8 to 10 lakh per day from a neighboring state, it's a cushion, actually. It's a benefit for the farmers. May not be for the for the customers. And somebody may say that if by increasing the production, the price may come down, consumer may get a better benefit. It's wrong. The MRP, the maximum retail price for milk there in Tamil Nadu, is higher than that here in Kerala. Even though the purchase price or the farmer price is much lower, the selling price is higher than that here in Kerala. That means there is no definite advantage of going for huge productions unnecessarily. The productivity has to be increased. The benefit has to be transferred to farmers, and better facilities has to be provided. Of course, all other infrastructure facilities that we can provide for absorbing the shock of additional the quantity production. For example, the spare drying plant, for that matter. Even though the spare drying is commercially not viable, but we know it during the pandemic period, COVID period, there in the beginning, it was impossible for a dairy plant operator here in Kerala to collect milk. See, for a particular dairy plant having a capacity of 1 lakh liters per day, their daily collection is 1 lakh. And if they're unable to sell it for a day, their storage facility may be 1.5 lakh. Next day, their quantity cannot be received there on the reception dock of the plant. Because after taking it out from the plant only, they can think about collecting it newly. That type of situation may come in between. And again, I told you 20% fluctuation will be during the flush season. 5 days to after 5 days, if 20% cannot be sold to other, means 1 day capacity will be excess there in the plant. That has to be handled. In that type of situation has to be addressed. Even though it is not viable on commercial terms, there is nothing wrong in thinking about or installing a spray drying plant which can absorb as a shock absorber. Now, the real issue with the dairy industry is that so far it was the problem of surplus. I'm sure that from here to next 3 or 4 months, there will be severe crisis for milk. Shortage will be there for milk. But it doesn't mean that that shortage will continue forever. That fluctuation will be there every year, but this year it will be on a higher side, mainly because of two reasons. One, during the initial period, throughout the period of COVID, the rate of insemination was less. And again, since there was a problem of shortage for feed and fodder, many were forced to sell animals. And at the same time, they were getting a better price for the animals because there was no animal available for the meat purpose. These two together had reduced the available stock here in Kerala. These together, the other reasons there in Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, where there also there is a dip in production. These all together may create a crisis here in next 2-3 months. But we have to consider all these fluctuations. We have to provide a sustainable system in which shock absorption is made possible by providing infrastructure facilities for absorbing the excess. And a plant increase only should be there in production. That should be our strategy for facing this type of what I can say attempts in attaining sufficiency for milk. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sudhir. Dr. Josh James has presented very nicely about the breeding policy, what is going on, being undertaken by KLDB, and the future plan of action to be taken. But I am sure that this is a very serious topic and should have got some more time. But unfortunately, because of our constraints of time, we are forced to stop, and we will have a better discussion. As Dr. Sudhir Babu also mentioned detail about the marketing and other future strategies. So thank you, both of you. And I hand over the platform to Dr. Professor Rama Kumar for further discussion on this topic. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shashindranath. Thank you to all the panelists for an excellent set of presentations, and particular Dr. Sudhir Babu's provocative point that actually the yearning for self-sufficiency may actually be creating more problems, and the problems of surplus may be more serious than the problems of deficit that we are currently facing. But I'm sure others will have a take on it, and how we can tackle such a situation if at all we come to it. And I hope to hear from others, including Dr. James, on what they think about that question. There are a number of questions that we have received via different fora that we have, and I'm going to summarize some of them to the panelists here. First is a question to the Vice Chancellor from Dr. A. Prasad. He thinks that there is a need for more fodder banks in Kerala. There is a need to change the times of milk collection. There is a need for vaccines against filaria. And we also need specific targeted nematode control programs. He would like the Vice Chancellor to comment on some of these aspects that he has raised. Dr. Gayatri has raised this question. Where do we draw the fine line in deciding how much crossbreeds we need, that is, which are bred deliberately following the breeding policy of the state? So fine line in deciding how much crossbreeds we need, but produce more milk than indigenous cattle in our state, which are actually repositories of many important genes adapted to our environment, but which produce lesser quantity of milk. So how do we tackle this problem is what Dr. Gayatri is raising. There is another question. Is there any policy to control the semen from private artificial insemination centers coming into Kerala population, which can disrupt the breeding policy accepted by our government? Do we know the details of the semen distributed by them? And won't it lead to inbreeding issues if they are not properly monitored? This is a question that I'm sure Joe James would be interested to take. Dr. Mridul Eepen, member of the planning board, has an interesting question. She asks, if you compare Punjab and Kerala milk yields, that is 14 per kg and 14 kg and 10 kg, is the difference more because of the better breeds in Punjab, or is it because cattle in Punjab are better fed, better nutritious food, and so on? So why is it that Punjab has more productivity than Kerala? That's something that she is very interested in. Mr. Jacob Abraham asks this question. I assume it is to Dr. Sudhir Babu. He asks, though the price of milk is on the higher side compared to other states, the cost of living, feed cost, etc., are very high in Kerala. In that condition, how can we say that the farmer is getting a reasonable price in Kerala? That is his question. There is another question on artificial insemination. The question is, free artificial insemination is also causing unwanted artificial insemination, or sometimes an exaggerated use of artificial insemination. So can we give subsidy directly to the farmer so that the government expenditure on this side can be reduced? That's a question. There's another question from Mr. P.T. Suraj. Is there any result of a gap analysis available, which has been conducted to assess the production loss of milk in Kerala between the potential yield and the actual farmer's yield? What are the major factors that lead to this kind of a gap in the yields between production, potential yield and farmer's yield? Dr. A. Prasad has another question. He asks, Tilaria is a major issue, but the cost of, and I'm trying to get the name right, Buparvacon, one dose, and the cost is rupees 1,200. Is there any possibility of making it available at a lower cost? Can we take up research to develop vaccines against Tilaria orientalis? And maybe Dr. Shashidranath can take up, or Dr. Jose James can consider that question. Then Dr. Raviraman, member of the planning board, has a question to Dr. Shashidranath. What is the status of husbandry skills available to us with respect to livestock keeping? I wonder how come we don't discuss much on the nature and availability of specific skills required in the dairy sector. In the Dutch dairy sector, they continue to scale up automation due to the cost of labor. Are we going to depend on migrant labor for this sector as well? Some reflections from others also is welcome, according to him. Jacob Abraham asked this question. Just by providing feed to the cattle farmer, rupees 20 per kg and milk price rupees 55 per liter, positive changes in the field naturally occur, according to him. It's more like a comment. Dr. Prasad continues with his comment. Yes, labor availability is important point. The automation has to suit the Kerala situation where the production system is with mini or medium farms. So we have to be innovative. Cannot mimic the developed countries and their models in dairy farming. This is Dr. Prasad's comment. Dr. Harita Pillai says, calf management needs need to be given more emphasis in policy. Suraj has yet another question. He says, on mechanization, many of our farmers are small and medium type. They're always looking to recover the money invested as early as possible. Only few are ready to invest with long-term plans. That may be the reason for less investment on mechanization, along with cheap availability of migrant labor. Maybe Dr. Sudhir Babu can make a comment on this particular point. There are some more questions, but one particular question is, we have started the ambitious program of electronic herd book. What is the scope of this electronic herd book that we have initiated in Kerala? Mr. Unnikrishnan has a question. One of the important reasons for low production and high disease incidence in Kerala is due to a severe deficiency of fiber in the diets. Diets based on TMR lines must be given priority. Are we doing anything in that direction? Again, both Dr. Sudhir Babu and Dr. Jose James can take up this question. These are the questions that have come up from the chat boxes in Facebook, YouTube, etc. I would also want to use this occasion to open up a little bit for about 5 minutes or so. We have very distinguished guests who are in the delegate room. I would like to request if any of them would like to make an oral comment at this point of time in the form of a question or in the form of a statement coming out of their long experience in this regard. I see Dr. Mahendra Yadav here. Maybe he wants to say a few words. May I request the organizers to kindly unmute Dr. Mahendra Yadav's mic so that he is able to speak to us. Dr. Yadav, just a moment, please.
Danya, please unmute. Unmute Yadav sir's mic. Yeah, done.
Now, okay. Yeah. Professor Ramakumar, Dr. M.R. Sridharnath, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Jose James, Dr. Sudhir Babu, Dr. Prasad, and other distinguished participants from the audience. Now, this afternoon, it was very interesting to have some idea of the present situation of dairying and livestock farming in Kerala. and certain, you see, points have surfaced. And as it is a pre-discussion to your 3 days subsequent international conference, where you have more experts there. Now, one problem highlighted here is concerning the feed and fodder or the nutrition. Now, maybe that the green fodder, like other places and all over India, we are deficient for green fodder also. So there are solutions for that. And we all know that hydroponic fodder is one alternative which can provide nutritious fodder or feed. And ultimately, it will be economic. When you have no other source of green fodder, so in those places, hydroponic fodder production can be thought of. Moringa and other alternatives are available depending on the climatic conditions. We can grow green fodder. Now, silent heat is a problem encountered in bovines, both in buffalo and cattle, in most of the parts of country because of the mineral deficiencies mainly. So I'm sure that like other states, Kerala is also having area specific mineral mixture. If not, your university can take up this agenda, and there are experts from nutrition, they can help and they can give further suggestion. Now at IVRI, when I was director there, we developed it was named as cristoscope to detect the silent heat. And this is very economic, costing only less than 2000, and is available in the market. And even a uneducated person, he can do this slide test, and they can identify whether the cow is in appropriate stage of heat for insemination. So every 4 hour, 2 hour, they can do this test, and they can know the appropriate time for insemination of the animal. The average milk production, which has been explained here, is quite encouraging. Now the problem of surplus, yeah, that is a important consideration. And after my retirement, I was associated with the Haryana Farmer Commission as consultant for animal husbandry, dairying and fisheries. Now there we suggested on the you see lines of Karnataka, in recent time, earlier Rajasthan, and on our recommendation, the Haryana government, they provided some incentive for the dairy farmers, small farmers producing milk, provided that milk is given to the processing plants, preferably in public sector and also in the private sector. The problem felt was that the milk plants in the public sector, they are not getting the required quantity. So their plants do not run on full capacity. So Karnataka gave up to 4 rupees per kg milk production. And the payment is made by the milk plant. The government gives money to the milk plant, and depending on the quantity of milk supplied by a farmer, he gets the payment back. And that works because we have to increase the profitability of the farmer. And this will solve the problem of surplus. the farmer income will be more. They will produce still more milk and plants will get milk. And then you have to plan for the utilization of the surplus milk. And maybe that milk powder or maybe casein, milk protein, which is in demand, or whey proteins. So that needs to be planned separately. But the glut and surplus, surplus and the deficient, this is a problem all over India, including Punjab and Haryana. So if we know the specific problems, then we can think of the their remedy in a efficient way. Now you have the sexed semen from good bulls from abroad, and definitely the animals will produce more. But for that, we have to feed them properly, appropriately, and we have to take care of the diseases. And there are a number of diseases, so and we have the vaccinations and vaccines. So your state can think in that direction. Deworming is very important for the young animals. And dewormings will improve the vaccine performances because these parasites, they are immunosuppressive. So this, in brief, a few points I would like to put, and I have put it here, but maybe that they, if the specific problems are brought before the experts, I think there are solutions now for many things. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Yadav. Thank you very much for your comments. Anybody else would like to make a very quick comment? You could raise your hand using the appropriate button. Is there anyone? If not, allow me to pass the baton on back to the Vice Chancellor. He can probably start answering.
Yeah, thank you.
Answering those questions which were put to him, and then invite the other two panelists. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Maybe may I request that we each speaker spends not more than 5 minutes in answering the questions. Thank you.
Thank you. So first, I will answer Dr. Prasad's question. We need more fodder banks. Yes, no doubt about it. This is one area where our Kerala is lacking. Because the availability of the fodder, the farmers are reluctant to cultivate. Even the farmer who is not having any cattle, they, if they are having land, they can cultivate fodder of different varieties, and they can sell through the cooperative society. Some system we have to make, and that this is an ideal suggestion, and we need to have that. Then need milk collection time to be extended. Yeah, this is another problem pointed out by field farmers of having extending the time of milk collection. That's it. Then the third question regarding Tularemia vaccine. Yes, Tularemia vaccine is there. Tularemia annulata vaccine is available. But in one of the study from Pukod Veterinary College, we could identify another strain, Tularemia orientalis. So this vaccine is available against Tularemia annulata, and it is, and cost of buparvaquone can be reduced it, but at this moment it is costly, and we will have to conduct a research and to find out suitable alternative. At this moment, buparvaquone is the only chemotherapeutic agent available for this tularemiasis. Nematode control program, certainly we have, but we have to rethink whether the present existing nematode control program is effective or not. If it is not effective, we will have to modify it. Certainly, these are the important points. And as Dr. Yadav, professor, has mentioned, that the worm burden will be suppressing the, even the vaccination. And not only that, the milk production and the standard growth, all these things happen. So nematode, effective nematode control program must be there. Then Dr. Levi Raman has pointed out some, whether the animal husbandry skill development. Yes, in the university we are giving training for the unemployed youth as well as those who are interested in for the husbandry skills in various for various species. Various species training programs are there, and it is being offered at a frequent interval. And the scale of automation. Scale of automation. The as Dr. Prasad has mentioned here, because of this cheaper labor available, they are semi. They are the farmers are doing mechanization. And for example, in milking machine is being utilized, but not we cannot compare with the developed countries. It is coming up, and tomorrow is the day it will be. We can have more mechanization. Then again, area specific mineral mixture was mentioned by Dr. Yadav. This is very important thing because infertility is one of the important problem in crossbred animals, and the silent heat is another because of all this mineral deficiency and all. Kerala Veterinary Animal Sciences University, they have conducted in our nutrition department the mapping of throughout Kerala. And the officers of animal husbandry department and other sister concerns, they are requesting the university to prepare this magnesium deficient, the mineral mixture for magnesium deficient or calcium deficient, depending on the result with regard to their soil and their fodder. So that is being propagated. And the TMR block is another diet acidosis. This is another important area where we have to concentrate because of lack of dry matter, lack of fodder, the acidosis develops and all microbes dies and the indigestion and all problems, even mastitis happens because of this. So this is another important area where we have to teach, we have to convey our technology to the farmers, and certainly they will be following once they are aware, we are making awareness about this, they will be following. Then TMR block, yes, Kerala Veterinary Animal Sciences University, we are making TMR blocks, and the farmer's adaptability to this TMR block is very low comparing because they are getting fodder, they are getting concentrate, and so at this moment they are not, but we are doing extension work and making awareness campaign, webinars and all. And these TMR blocks will be of much useful, especially during our calamity period and all, where we cannot grow fodder and green grass or anything. So this is already there, and it is available in KVISU feed mill, and on order it can be supplied. So these are the things which I think I feel I have to answer. If any more questions are there, they can put forward. And thank you. And I pass on to Dr. Joseph James, please.
Yeah, thank you, Sachindra sir. Regarding one question about why there is a difference productivity between Punjab and Kerala, I should say the major issue is the feeding part, because we know Punjab has the maximum feed residues, maximum feed production, and so they are able to feed quite a large number of residues from the paddy and wheat and other things. So feeding is one important thing. Second thing is, if you see the population of Punjab, it will be more of Holsteins, because there they have a progressive dairy farmers association and they are bringing in pure Holsteins more, and they are maintaining the animals for milk. Once the milking is over, maybe two lactations, afterwards they are just shifting it to UP or some other states. So there's a very high turnover of animals going over there, unlike in the case of Kerala, where we have a tradition of keeping animals. Farmers, once who come into the business, at least a certain percentage of animals they will be keeping, but definitely feeding is on a higher path. So that could be one major reason Punjab. Second question, one question was there from some Gayatri regarding the fine line of crossbreds. See, we should understand one thing. As per the 7 breedable animals in the state, which is producing about 25.5 lakh metric tons of milk. So we cannot simply increase the number of animals because there should be a carrying capacity. Our state should be able to carry the animals. So we are not saying that this is the optimal number, but we should go at least by 1 lakh or so more. And at the same time, we have to improve the productivity. Both these has to be considered. Regarding the private AI centers, definitely that's a very big issue, which we have been raising in many of the forums. And fortunately or unfortunately, or knowingly or unknowingly, many of the professionals in this sector are, you know, more interested in their commercial things, and they are also encouraging. I'm very sorry to say that, because they are not knowing the efforts taken by the government and the agencies in this sector to produce germplasm suited to our situation. But simply showing a calf which is having 50 kg birth weight, which produces maybe in non-lactation superior milk, but that dies off soon. So that is what the private agencies are showing. They are bringing in some HF and other things and showing the poor farmers, probably the, you know, the progressive farmers with very good resources may be able to maintain them, but not the average farmer or the milk producer in the state. And I understand that the government of Kerala has already moved for the Bovine Breeding Act. It is in the final stages. Punjab has already implemented that. Tamil Nadu has implemented that. And definitely the state of Kerala is also going for that. That's what I understand. And then we have to curb all these unwanted germplasm in the state. And because there is a government agency which is open to all, anybody can do the things, see what is happening. And they should have some trust on the agency. Otherwise, nothing is going to happen. Free AI was one, it's a policy issue. We are not supposed to comment on that. But there was an occasion when exaggerated use was there. But if you see for the last 3-4 years, Department of Animal Husbandry has gone up very fast in maintaining softwares. Now the Government of India is insisting on a national software, INAF, and the department is also doing that. That's what somebody has asked on electronic herd book. But here also the problem is INAF is a very comprehensive software. And unfortunately, the people who are doing the data entry, they just finish it off with the registration. They are not going further, because if they want to go further, they have to go and in depth into the field, follow it up and then enter the data. That is not happening here. So the expected results from this herd book maintenance is not being achieved by the state. That is a very important thing which the policy makers should also see, because the technical personnel should enter the data and follow it up and then come out with the results through the software. So that is not happening. The provisions are there in all the AI centers and all agencies. Then deficiency of fiber, I think our honorable VC has told, that is one major issue. And other than TMR, why can't we think of fodder? We have to think of fodder, because all of us know the acetic acid problem, it's a precursor of fat. And we are without fiber, nothing is going to happen. So then in the double axis pricing also, the milk price will come down naturally to the farmers, which is again a loss to him. So naturally, we have to increase the fiber content in the field, either through increasing fodder, because paddy straw, we cannot depend on the long run, because the variety has come down. It's a dwarf variety. Cultivation has come down by 50%. We are depending on imported. So TMR is another option. Kerala Feeds has come up with fodder blocks. But unfortunately, the marketing on that fodder block is not that good, I should say, because many of the farmers doesn't know what is the fodder block and its availability. Then regarding one thing about the gap analysis, definitely, if I am right, in 1980, there was a study conducted by the Center for Development Studies about the policy options for cattle development. Dr. K. N. Nair and Dr. Raj Kamal, Dr. Unitan and all. Thereafter, there has been no comprehensive study except for two interim studies, which has been carried out by NDDB, Animal Husbandry Diary, together in the state about 6 years back. They were more concentrating on the AI delivery issues. That was a very important study, but unfortunately, the report has not come out. Why? I don't know. Because as I told in the presentation, a lot of effort is going in improving the genetic pool. But how far it is reaching the farmer to get a good output, that is a question. So that was one study. Then thereafter, there was a study which was conducted by the Lidage from the milk producers and societies. There also, this AI delivery issues were discussed. So that's why I told there should be a situation analysis. What is happening in the change scenario? That is very important. And mechanization, everybody can say of mechanization, but for an average farmer, we have to think of indigenizing the mechanization part and not depending on the corporates, because it will not be a break-even for them. We have to think of some, like the Kalapaji College, or somebody should come up, or the agriculture department, or somebody should come up with some low-cost technology to mechanize the fodder production part or the animal husbandry part. I think I have covered almost all the portions, questions. If there are any more questions.
Dr. James, before I pass it on to Dr. Sudhir Babu, there's been a flow of questions after you started to speak. So I should do justice to them. So I'm just going to add a couple of three questions to all of you. I hope you don't mind.
Yes, sir, please.
There's one question from Jacob Matthew. He says we can increase production without animal import by A, reducing the inter-calving interval by 1 month per animal by providing supplements, inducing early heat, hormone therapy, awareness creation, etc. Number two, we can reduce cost of production by improving germplasm to optimum, considering climate change, generalizing mechanization, and making available good quality fodder at cheaper rate, and then support farmers using interest subsidy and incentives. That is one question that he has, whether it is possible. There's one more question from Dr. Mridu Lipan. She says there is still a potential demand for milk we have not tapped, especially flavored milk for ICDS children in Anganwadis and school children while they take midday meals. If we consider this demand also, there'll be a huge demand out there, and the overproduction problem can be tackled by considering some of these as outward channels. Deepu Matthew speaks about the issue of livestock ration cards, like the food grain ration cards that we have. If this is the case, then 10% for all cows, even a token subsidy of 10% for all the cows, irrespective of APL, BPL, can work wonders for the dairy sector of the state. Likewise, goat feed, poultry feed, etc., can be given based on the ration card. So basically, he's asking for issue of feed at subsidized rates on the basis of livestock ration cards. There is Mridulipan further asks, and I think Sudhir may have to take up that. Should we bother so much about surplus milk production? Are you scaremongering, or is it a real issue? So that's I think Dr. Joseph James very cleverly evaded that question. Maybe I should poke him a little bit more on this. Suraj PT, countries with high producing dairy cows are having a clear plan on soil fertility management that ensures nutrient-rich, dense fodder and feed ingredients. So why don't we have such an approach, is his question. Anil Kumar has a counter to your answer on Punjab. He says, Punjab has around 25 lakh cattle and only 17% are indigenous cattle. Why is it that they have such high levels of productivity? That's after hearing your answer, he has posted this comment. Then there is another question. Kerala, it is the only state which shows reduction in... Anil Kumar further continues. I'll keep that question aside. Dr. Anis says, unless we have an increased agricultural byproduct output, along with increasingly mini dairy farms, farmers are always put in difficulty locally. What do you think, is this question. Dr. Sindhu from the Malambura farm asks, why not popularize breeds like Vechur, which are suitable for small spaces and small families? That's a question. So I will may I request Dr. Joseph James to continue for 2-3 more minutes, not more than that. Quick answers, and later we have to give Dr. Sudhir Babu also his allotted time. Thank you.
So regarding the first question on, I think Dr. Jacob Matthew, reducing intercalving period, you know, and all of the things that has already, you know, the reproductive management improvement should be there, because once Kerala has gone to crossbreeding, we know about the crossbreeding in agriculture. What is happening to the hybrid mangoes and other things, how they are being managed. Similarly, when the hybrids are coming up, naturally, the physical stature as well as the, they are bringing in more diseases, especially on the reproductive side also. So that is a very good suggestion on reducing intercalving period so as to improve the total productivity of the animal. That is well taken, but I think the department has a lot of programs on that, and that has to be little more tightened. The nuts and bolts have to be tightened so that that will be taken care of. And you know, Kerala has the advantage because the farmers themselves, you know, they are doing a selection. Unlike in many other states, we are having the freedom to dispose of the animals also. So they are not keeping any animal which is of substandard quality, either on the production or on the reproduction. And definitely subsidy. Subsidies, we are not sure how long can the government go on with subsidies in this area. But that I am not unable to answer on that also. Then regarding the livestock ration cards, it's an excellent suggestion. To be frank, we actually started with this about 10 years back. And these cards were printed and as a booklet and given to almost all the AI centers. But unfortunately, what I told earlier is our technical officers are very poor in documentation because they are they will do the work, but they cannot place it on record. So if you give the ration card, there should be some entries in time so as to derive some useful results. Otherwise, there is no meaning. That is a very good suggestion, and we can think of that also. Then goat feed and poultry feed, of course, the demand is there, but that the feed manufacturers have to take care. I think Kerala Feeds has a goat feed manufacturing in Adavanad, Malappuram, and KLDB is at least buying from the goat feed for our goat farm. It's an excellent feed that can be depended upon. Soil fertility management, it's very important, but we have soil conservation approaches, but not soil management or fertility management. We can burn anything anywhere. Nobody is bothered about the soil fertility. Unlike in the Netherlands and all, you know, there are very hard restrictions on even using of fertilizers, everything. So soil fertility management is very important, especially when comparing the different terrains of the state as highland, midland, lowland and all. In the highlands, the fertility of the soil is very poor. And so that approach should be there. And increased mini dairy farms is a good suggestion because now, you know, the generation change has come in. People are just evading themselves from livestock keeping. So at least some people, they come up with more of semi-commercial or commercial farms that will definitely support the state in milk production, but not in the government sector, because government sector farms have their own limitations, problems, procedural issues. And popularizing vechur, that effort the state is taking. Government of India has been supporting since last 2-3 years, and a lot of money has been given to many farmers. But now the government of India is also telling, okay, it is for your state, so let the state take up. Vechur, of course, is a good animal, but on commercial terms, we cannot say that is good. But we have to get more of vechur animals, and a lot of misuse is happening because KLDB is giving vechur cement to all the AI centers who require it. But unfortunately, that is not going into the correct animal. And they are simply using the vechur cement on some dwarf animal, producing some dwarf kids, calves, and telling that is vechur, selling it at premium prices. So that business should not be allowed. There should be some ethics while using germplasm. That is why in my presentation, I told you AI delivery should be very judicious. The technician is the man who decides which animal to be impregnated with which cement. And if that is paka, then there won't be any issue in the genetic improvement. And on the last question of Dr. Anil Kumar, I fully agree with you. 83% of the animals are there, exotic or crossbreds. But I told you, they are keeping more of purebreds. They don't go for this crossbred or Rathi or some other things. They have two separate lines. That is one for indigenous. They upgrade the indigenous. The other one, they are going with pure Holsteins. They want to improve the volume of milk. And you know, even in Punjab, there are agencies of many multinational companies providing sexed semen at Indian rates. That is the situation. So we cannot compare with Punjab. The attitude of the farmers, the entrepreneurship, everything, there's quite a lot of difference with Kerala and Punjab. And the availability of land and fodder, that is most important. I think I have almost covered, and for the demand for school and all, I think Sudhir Babu sir can.
Yeah. Dr. Sudhir, please. Thank you.
Yeah. Mr. Jacob Abraham was mentioning regarding the pricing of milk. See, nobody is against increasing the price. But the issue is that, for example, if you are increasing the price of milk here in Kerala by 10 rupees, it will never help the farmers. Unnecessary increase means then the gap between the price available here in Kerala and Tamil Nadu will again go up. And naturally, that itself will create more inflow of milk from the neighboring states. Gradually, what will happen? The society, the producers' cooperative society may not be able to absorb the entire quantity of milk. Generally, we used to say the primary purpose. Otherwise, I can say that the guarantee that the farmers of Kerala, they are getting at present, the entire quantity of surplus milk produced by the farmers is being collected by the APCOs. And once the price is revised, in Kerala condition, it will never come down. But in many other states, the lowering down of price also used to happen. That's the advantage that we are getting at present. It is you have a buyer forever. Once the price is revised, that will be revised forever. That situation has to be maintained. And again, from the farmer side, generally they used to supply. For example, if somebody is producing 60 or 70 liters of milk, they will try to go for neighborhood marketing. 40 liters will be sold at 60 rupees per liter. And the rest 20 liters, they will be pouring to a society at 38 rupees per liter. And you can't compare between this 38 and 60. You can't expect it also. And again, keep it in mind, near about 78 to 80% of the MRP rate of milk is being paid to the farmers here. It's a better price. It's a better price. You can't say that the price available at present. If you're comparing with the other one, 60 price, 60 rupees that you are getting for fresh milk, you will never get it for the society supply, one. Second, as about the fear about surplus, it's a real fear, no doubt. Deficit, you can always manage by getting the milk from somewhere else. But surplus means that the quantity is going beyond your control. Yada also was mentioning many other states, the milk surplus states there in Haryana, Punjab, and all. Cooperatives were becoming unviable primarily because of excess production. And that situation has to be avoided. That's it.
Right. Thank you. Thank you very much. From my side, I want to thank the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Jose James, and Dr. Sudhir Babu for that thought-provoking presentations, which leaves some questions unanswered. Some doubts remain. I'm sure more discussions are required on the whole strategy to achieve self-sufficiency, how best to go about it. And I must say, the Punjab problem remains in some sense. The Kerala-Punjab comparison remains not fully understood, in my opinion. Maybe we need more thought to go into that comparative analysis also. And I'm sure the university can lead some effort to understand those changes in productivity, those variations in productivity that we see between Kerala and Punjab. That might be an interesting topic for possibly a dissertation or so. Anyway, thank you very much. That is a very interesting session. I must now pass it on to Mr. S.S. Nagesh, Chief Agriculture Division, the State Planning Board, for the formal vote of thanks. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ramakumar. That is a very interesting session with lot of delegates, around 265 delegates. First of all, I must thank Dr. M.R. Sashindranath for a wonderful, making it a wonderful chair, and Dr. Josh James, Managing Director, Kerala Livestock Development, for flagging all those issues and answering almost all the queries, and Dr. Sudhir Babu, who is a well-known personality in dairy sector, for having come for this session. Then I should thank distinguished Professor Dr. Mahendra Yadav, he is former director of IVRA, And also, Director ICAR, NIA, NP, and so many distinguished personalities from the field of veterinary sciences and dairy sciences were present. I also thank the directorate, the veterinary college, the dairy college, professors who wholeheartedly participated. Dr. Ashok, I can see the registrar is there. And almost all the entire veterinary fraternity and dairy fraternity of Kerala participated in this discussion. I thank all of them, including the DAHOs, the district aggregate, the animal husbandry officers. And last, not the least, I should thank the team, the control room team, the rapporteur team, and the social media team of agriculture division, and all my colleagues. And thank you, Dr. Ram Kumar. That's just a formality for conducting the session so well. Thank you so much. I welcome you to the detailed discussion international session on 2nd of February. So we'll be sending the delegate a link to all of you. Kindly participate and deliberate on various topics. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
The meet is over.